Thank you very much, Tony, for the very nice invitation. This is a great workshop about 2D materials. So I'm going to try to change a little bit the point of view. I guess from electrical engineering, and I'd like to find more applications at terahertz and infrared about how can we use 2D materials in this frequency range. I'm also going to try to find some use to develop metasurfaces in order to control and manipulate light, electromagnetic waves in a somehow different way. Some of my results, they are going to be kind of similar to what Professor Menon just shown, because we are also working on hyperbolic metamaterials, and also we have done. I'm also part of that experiment that he was showing in the group of Andrea Lu, where we are just sending the different ballet, the different we are measuring the elicity from the from MOSFET-2 coupled to a metasurface. So it's kind of a different perspective, but well, let's go. If this move. Okay, so I'm going to talk first about plasmonic devices and how can we use 2D materials to develop new devices at terahertz and infrared, and why they provide an advantage compared to the state of the art. This is more taken from a more purely engineering perspective. Then I'm going to move to metasurfaces in the sense of hyperbolic metasurfaces. How can we control the isofrequency dispersion? How can we control implying light that is propagating on surface plasmon within the plane? And also, if there is some properties that we can take advantage, for instance, canalization, or if we can have any new applications in other fields. And then I'm going to try to exploit some of the responses of graphene, for instance, the field effect, in order trying to break reciprocity without using magnetic fields. So this is one direction that we are working very recently on, and that we believe it could have some very nice impact. Very nice outcome. So let's start with plasmonic devices. Well, you have been listening about 2D materials all day, so I'm not going to tell you anything that you already know. So I just want to mention that in the frequency regions, for instance, on terahertz, there is the so-called terahertz gap, and there the technology somehow is not so well developed as in electronics or photonics. And there, when graphene appeared, it created like a very large impact, because it provided some properties that we couldn't find in any other material. In particular, this thing doesn't actually work. Not really. OK, so I'm going to stay here. So in particular, graphene was known to provide to support surface plasmons. And as we just learned from the previous speaker, surface plasmons, they are just electromagnetic waves that are bounded at the interface between a dielectric and a metal, that at optics, this metal has a negative permittivity. So these plasmons are electromagnetic waves that are propagating at the interface, and they are just confined through that interface. In order for these plasmons to appear, what you need is to have a material with negative permittivity, which is the role that noble metals like gold or silver, they play at optics. If we analyze graphene, or if we just take the effective, for instance, using the cube of formalism, we can take what is the effective conductivity macroscopically of graphene, it turns out that the imaginary part of graphene has a negative permittivity that plays the same role as this negative permittivity at optics. And that result, and that's, that response appears at terahertz. So that was really, really interesting, because that means that we can have, for instance, as shown in this graph of Professor Engeta, published a few years ago, it means that we can have surface plasmons at terahertz, and that was not possible before. And that opened like a lot of interest. And of course, as it is very well known, we can also just apply a small bias and change the chemical and just the electrical, the Fermi level of graphene, and we can control the properties. So some This is an example of propagation of surface plasmons of graphene. This is just for the sake of illustration. We can have like a 2D, just the plane here, and we can see how the electromagnetic wave is attached to graphene as it is evanescent on the medium above and below, and it is just propagating here. Of course, the propagation length is going to depend on the quality of graphene, if we have more defects, less defects, etc. But the phenomenon is there, and it was very, very interesting. So from my perspective as an electrical engineer, I was trying to model this 2D material somehow macroscopically. So I just try, I'm not gonna dig into the all of these phenomena that are exactly at the very low scale and nanometers. So I prefer to take like a very macroscopic approximation where I take a phenomenological scattering rate or relaxation rate of graphene in order to know and to model how it behaves. So if we just plot this conductivity versus frequency, we can see here, we can plot the real and the imaginary part versus different chemical potentials, or we can just take the inverse and plot the surface impedance. What we're going to see is that if we are operating at microwave, relatively low frequencies, graphene is going to behave mostly as a resistor, that you can chain the value of the resistor by applying a voltage. But as long you are entering into the terahertz and go higher to terahertz, the graphene presents an inductive or a metallic response that is the one that allows the propagation of surface plasmas. And it is the one that is really, really interesting. So why graphene, or why I was trying to be, I was interested in this material? Well, we can have evanescent wave, we have the surface plasma, so we can have subdiffraction and resolution, so we can have like many, many applications. We are going to have field enhancement, so we can apply this. So people have been applying the last years to develop sensors, detectors, and you have learned a lot about all of this today. We can have reconfigurability, which is a very interesting property when we are operating at terahertz, where we can actually use varactors that are more common at lower frequency, and maybe reconfiguration is not so easy. It's a challenging problem. And we are also interested to match terahertz sources where we have some problems, or where the technology, it has been also developed, and maybe the use of 2D materials can provide new solution to these challenges. So, well, this is like the very simple, or the simplest way that I could find to express the dispersion relation of graphene. I assume that just graphene is on free space, and I just want to show you what is going to be the evolution of this of the wave vector that is propagating here. We're assuming that this is in free space. And as you know, graphene is going to support these plasmons that are going to be very slow wave. They're going to be very confined. And we can control how much these waves are going to be confined if we change the chemical potential, which that means is that if we apply a small voltage, we're going to be able to change that, which is really, really good. We can also analyze the quality factor of graphene. For instance, here we are just plotting the imaginary part versus the loss. It's like the wave vector versus the loss. And of course here it depends on the relaxation time. What is the quality of your sample? And the last thing that I just want to briefly like remind you, like main properties, is the strong field confinement. Is that the plasmon is going to be confined? It's going to be attached to graphene, to this layer. So this is like the major, or some of the main properties that we can use as a tool in order to develop new properties, or to analyze some applications where we can use the 2D materials. Thus, for instance, some people some time ago, it was like a very simple thing is to develop a switch at terahertz. It was really challenging because there the technology it has some problems, and they were just applying a very small voltage just below one of, for instance, we have just a graphene strip where we have a plasma propagating. If we just apply a voltage below, we can control what are going to be the properties of the graphene. on the top. So we can just apply in a very strong, well, not so strong, we just apply in a few volts, we were able to allow or to forbid the propagation of the surface plasmons, which is kind of relatively simple, and I don't think that anyone is surprised here. But the fact that we can do that at terahertz, that opened like a new, was something very exciting to learn. And also maybe more related to control of electromagnetic wave, like in terms of filtering of wave at microwave, you can also develop like filters at terahertz, just controlling how is the propagation constant, how the plasmon is going to each of the sections where it is propagating. So in this case, if you just have some gating pads below for graphene and you just apply several voltages, and of course you know how this is going to affect to the propagation constant, to the characteristic impedance and properties of the regions that are on the top, you can control how the energy is propagating, and you can develop low-pass filters, for instance, that are able to have a very sharp response. And that since we are able to tune these voltages to the different gating paths, we can control the cutoff frequency, which was something very interesting. Then people are just trying to extend this concept to develop bandpass filter, to develop a phase shifter, just trying to enable to use these 2D materials, you know, to develop devices at terahertz, like we can see here. So one of the major problems, well, not major problems, but one of the problems that we came across analyzing these devices was the non-locality of graphene, or the fact that sometimes the fields were so confined that the electrons were not able to follow the electrons were not able to follow the variations of the electric field. So in that case, if we need to take into account the non-locality of graphene in order to see how is going to be the response of the devices, considering this non-locality. There are several models out there which can be used in order to analyze this phenomenon, and this is something that can impose some problems in terms of, for instance, in the response of phase shifter, it's going to provide some errors, and it's going to have some deviation that we need to take into account. Well, so when I started working on graphene in my postdoc at EPFL a few years ago, we were just trying to use it to develop a simple antenna, or an antenna at terahertz, or antennas at low frequency, and the most simpler idea that we have is like, let's see how if we can use graphene to make an antenna at microwave, a regular component. So we just make a very simple simulation. We just make the analysis, the matching the antenna. We have a very good matching, and we thought like, hey, maybe we can use graphene as a great antenna. It's going to be reconfigurable, and we are going to be able to have a very good results. And very something very impactful. The problem is that everything was not so easy. And the problem is that at microwave graphene was mostly a resistor, so it wasn't able to radiate. We weren't able to couple all the energy to free space. So what happened is that we obtained a very good matching in our antenna, in the sense that all the energy was able to be accepted in the structure, but then it was dissipated there. And then the amount of energy that could radiate to free space was extremely, extremely low. So I'm considering that at microwave at these frequencies, an standard antenna can get above 90% of radiation efficiency, going out to the market with the radiation efficiency below 5%, that doesn't make any sense. So, but it was good. We were just learning. And then we have the idea, it's like, what happens if we go higher in frequency? What happens if we go at terahertz? And then we just have graphene on gallium arsenide, like a standard photoconductive antenna, where it is illuminated by a laser with some DC bias. And then what happened here is that we found some very nice results, because usually if we try to understand this antenna in the sense that we are going to have a source, the presence of the photomixer can be modeled as a source with a very high input impedance. That's why when I don't know if you have seen these terahertz antennas, that they have all of these log, like a spiral type of sections, which are kind of complicated, because they are trying to enhance like the input impedance on the way that all the energy is going to be accepted by the antenna. And the point that the input impedance of this structure was really high is usually a problem that that is difficult to overcome. So what we realized with graphene is that the input impedance that we were able to obtain at terahertz was just much larger, just due to the characteristics of the plasmons that were supported by graphene. We also learned that of course we can apply a DC bias. We can control where is going to be resonant our antenna. This is like a very small dipole that is going to radiate. And it was interesting in the sense that it is lossier than, for instance, gold. That is the material that have usually been applied here. But the fact that the amount of energy that was able to be accepted by the antenna was larger make that the total radiation efficiencies that we obtained in this analysis was larger. So there is like a trade-off in the sense that we have more loss, but we are able to put more amount of power into the antenna, so the radiation efficiency that we were able to obtain was larger. So it was like a good trade-off, and then we just obtained this standard radiation pattern of any dipole. We just put like a small silicon lens below just to have some directivity, because otherwise it's an electrically small antenna and it radiates like a potato, like everywhere, omnidirectional. We just we continue a little bit with this. We just with a roll dipole, there is nothing, there is not much difference with this type of work, just that we're gonna have like very high input impedance we can control, and the response is very similar. We also try to apply this concept that right now is theoretical, then we're going to try to go to some experiments, is in the concept of leaky wave antenna, in the sense that if we are able to control the conductivity of graphene, if we are able to control the imaginary the reactance and the way that all the electromagnetic wave and plasmons are propagating there, maybe we can also control what is the direction toward which the beam that we is going to be radiated. So in order to do so, what we wanted to, we just got inspired by some very old papers from the 60s, that say that if you have a surface that is periodically modulated, you are going to have an infinite number of Floquet harmonics, and probably the harmonics minus one is going to cross the fast wave regions, which means that it's going to be able to radiate to free space. It was a topic that was kind of, after Professor Olliner developed that in the 60s, 70s, it was somehow forgotten, and then it took like some kind of renewed interest in the past recent years. What some people start developing this type of antennas at microwave. So here the idea is that if you are able to control the periodicity of your structure, like make it sinusoidally modulated, you are going to have a structure able to radiate a leaky wave antenna to a one particular direction in space. And of course, if you change frequency, you're going to be able to scan the space in that. So we just were trying to apply if we could be able to develop this type of antennas using graphene or a terahertz, because we have the very good matching source here. So we know that the amount of energy that could go there could be larger than in case of the other, in the case that other antennas are terahertz. So here the idea is that if we are able to put a few gating pads below of a simple graphene strip, here the dimensions are in micrometers, so we don't actually care about the fringes effect here are really little, and we apply different voltages here, we are able to effectively modulate the surface impedance. Then what is going to happen is that the energy is going to be radiated to different locations in space as a function of this modulation period, which is like, so we can have several several cases, so we can just change this spatial modulation. We can control, we can tune towards which direction the beam is gonna be radiated. So we perform some simulations. We were able to control towards which angle the energy is gonna be going. And also very interesting is like if we fix frequency, we're able to scan the full space, which was very interesting, especially because we were discussing at terahertz where such functionalities were required, but they are not readily available. So in just an overview, this is I would say that we're just trying, because this is like I just wanted to give like an introduction, some overview of how graphene could be used for engineering applications. This is something that I was doing in my postdoc in EPFL, and then for some reasons I moved away, and they couldn't, when we were starting doing the experiments, many things happened and we couldn't actually do the experiment. It's something that I'm trying to do right now in my group at the University of California, Davis, just because if we are able to demonstrate such enhancement of terahertz radiation, it can have a very significant impact. So it's something that even though it's somehow old, but I think it can have a very nice impact. And I also want to say that, of course, there are some challenges. It's like, for instance, in the case of the leaky wave antenna, we need to make the biasing paths, and always the excitation and loss is something that we need to take into account in order to make these devices work. Well, some other direction that we try to develop in the past is just trying to modulate terahertz beams. And we wanted, for some applications that some project that we have with the industry in the past, we're just trying to control the beams in terahertz in transmission. So since we wanted to modulate this beam, we wanted to somehow get rid of the gating paths from below in order to control the terahertz wave. And we came up with a simple solution in the sense that we just wanted to have like two a graphene layer very close to each other. It was like a separation of around 70 nanometers. It was just the PMMA layer between when you have graphene, and then we just transfer a different one on top in order to manipulate or to control a terahertz beam that is propagating on the way. So first we just put some contact paths with gold. We just have CVD graphene. We don't have, not even close, the high quality of graphene that these guys were showing this morning. I'm sorry, we tried, we didn't get it. The quality was just average, not high quality. So I acknowledge that. And we just make the standard Raman. We realized that we have two single graphene layers, and we have that structure with the separation layer was a PMMA of around 70-80 nanometers. And we just make like a terahertz time domain spectroscopy. So we just sent a pulse, and we obtained a modulation depth around 20-25%, which was very good compared to what we were expecting. We also have the loss was something to I don't remember right now the exact number, but it was significant, the amount of loss that we found. But the modulation depth, it wasn't amazing, but the fact that we could operate in transmissions was really promising and encouraging, and also the fact that we could apply this technology to control electromagnetic wave. Then, of course, we just analyzed how one layer was able to bias the other one, but this is nothing new that I would like to spend some time on that. And I also want to mention that, for instance, the other groups, they reported like graphene modulators, for instance, using like some Fabry-Perot resonant, and you just put graphene on the top, and then when the beam comes, you can absorb all the energy or not, as we can see here, and then just applying a small amount of voltage, you obtain a huge a modulation of the power reflectance. So then they were able to demonstrate modulation depth around 60-70%, which was really, really good. But it was operating in reflection. In our case, just for some application, we were working on transmission. But in any case, what I wanted just to highlight here is the fact that these 2D materials may have a high impact in some areas where right now other materials, they are somehow they are not able to provide a very the performance that we obtain is not so high as we want. We was something that we could go we can improve. So it was like the first part of my talk, just to introduction a little more. Introduction. After today, you knew this very well. And right now, I just wanted to go to move with metasurfaces. Most likely, I'm going to review about hyperbolic metasurfaces. I'm going to overlap a little bit with some of the material that Professor Venant just presented. And but before of doing that, it's like we want to develop electromagnetic metasurfaces in order to control wave. We want to control electromagnetic wave, and we want to have something really, really thin, able to change the polarization, able to change the direction of the reflection, able to change how this wave is operating. So for that, we just got inspired for this metamaterial concept that was put forward like many years ago and was the object of a lot of research. And we have a natural material where the, for instance, the atoms are really, really small in terms of the operating wavelength. And if we have a metasurface, for instance, made of 2D materials, it's ultra thin, but we can just pattern, or we can just make scatters, or we can just make like small dipoles or nanoantennas, which are much smaller than the wavelength of light. So it can be seen like a homogeneous medium that can provide some functionality. So that's the key. This is not something new, and it has been the object of in very intense research during the last year. You can find thousands, maybe not so many as in the case of 2D materials, but many, many papers are out there about this. So one of the things that drew most attention was, for instance, phase from engineering. Like you are coming from with a beam, and then you are able to chain to modify Snell law in the sense that you can direct the beam towards any direction that you want. This is something interesting. Okay, it was that paper of Generalis Snell law, and my background is in microwave, and the concept of reflector ray is very, very similar. And there are like since the 60s or the 70s, people have been working in those topics. So it's sometimes very interesting how we can go and learn from one field to the other and try to make things. Anyway, so there has been like many, many works on this, like just playing with the scatters. You can just control where is going to be the beam reflected, what is going to be the polarization. You can control with some wavelength precision what is going to be the future of the beam. You can have like in nonlinear optics, you can have very high efficiency, you can have plasmons, you can have spoof plasmons. There is like a wide variety or one variety of systems based on metasurfaces that have provided a very nice functionalities. So that's the key is just trying to manipulate electromagnetic wave, controlling the size and the type of the scatters within the metasurfaces. So within that, I will just to talk a little bit about the hyperbolic metamaterials, because I want to make the transition to hyperbolic metasurfaces. So if we have just a regular medium, for instance, free space like air, we know that the dispersion relation is just bounding. We just have a sphere in the momentum space. And I just see that like if we have some physicists that they are trying to go right above the light line, but they cannot go, they are somehow bounded. But if we just change the dispersion relation, if we have like a hyperbolic medium, then we can just have some birds which are flying, which are free, and that means that the momentum towards which they can get is really, really high. Ideally, it's infinite, but it is not. We are going to have loss that is going to close the isofrequency contour. We are going to have a spatial dispersion that is going to close the isofrequency contour, and also we are going to have if the momentum is really, really high, also maybe the Fermi velocity of the electrons is not going to be fast enough to follow the field variation, so it's going to close the isofrequency contour. But in most of the cases, we are going to have momentum values which are going to be much larger than what we may have with an isotropic response. So there has been like many, many type of hyperbolic bulk metamaterials. And for instance, there was some, I don't even don't remember exactly the name, but there are some minerals that they behave as hyperbolic metamaterials in some particular frequency region. We can also make like an alternative layers of metal and dielectric in order to have one response capacitive and inductive of metal dielectric in different directions, or a single like wire medium. So there are many ways to develop and construct these hyperbolic metamaterials. And there are some very nice work in the back. For instance, one of the professor Menon here, when he was working about topological transition, canalization, enhancement of the spontaneous emission rate. But it's also somehow challenging in the sense that it's bulk, so the access to the bulk hyperbolic mode is complicated. We have volumetric loss, and somehow can also be complicated to integrate with other components. So what we proposed some years ago is like, if we have, for instance, a 2D layer, and we just have the conductivity tensor, and we can try to control how it's gonna behave. If we have, for instance, graphene, this is just the isofrequency control, and we know that we have just a dipole, the dipole is going to excite the surface plasmon, and it's going to propagate towards all directions simultaneously. It's like isotropic response. But if we are able to engineer one of these direction of the conductivity tensor, maybe we can just direct all the energy towards one particular direction, like kind of similar to what is happening in the canalization in the bulk. Or if we're able to make one of the directions metallic, and metallic here, and dielectric on the perpendicular direction, or capacitive inductive, we're going to have a hyperbolic response that is going to have a performance very similar to what you can find in the bulk, but with the difference is that, of course, the fields below and above, they are going to be still evanescent. So it's not exactly dual. So this also has some nice properties. How can we realize this in practice? Well, there are many ways. For instance, if we just have nanostructured graphene, where we can have like these graphene ribbons, and this direction is going to be inductive, and this one you're going to have a capacitive coupling that is going to provide the hyperbolic response. Then you can have a black phosphorus. It's a material that provides hyperbolic responses. You also have there were some recent experiments, well, a few years ago, with silver or of chlorine, the hexagonal boron nitride metasurfaces. There was this experiment very recently in science where they also demonstrate the presence of these hyperbolic plasmons. And what can we do with these hyperbolic plasmons? Well, we just try to see if there are some nice properties. So we just assume that here we have like a plasmon coming here, we have an interface here, and then we're going to see if we have here a hyperbolic medium, we can control the refractive angle. And if we have, if we go to the analogy in the bulk, we know that this angle, we can have a negative refraction. So just changing with the hyperbolic response, we can control to have negative angles. We can have super Planckian thermal emission just because we are taking advantage of the near field to the near field fields, which just, otherwise are the ones that bounce the black body radiation. We can have subwavelength resolution, as was previously mentioned, and there are like many applications which can really benefit for the presence of hyperbolic for the hyperbolic plasmas. One very interesting thing is just to analyze the spontaneous emission rate when we are in very close to a hyperbolic medium. For instance, if we have in the bulk, the spontaneous emission rate or the local density of state is going to be huge, but you need to put the source inside the hyperbolic medium, because if you put the source outside, the coupling to this hyperbolic medium is not so good. However, in this case, since you just put a dipole here, we can just try to compute what is the spontaneous emission rate, and if we just have graphene, or if we have a hyperbolic metasurface. So the idea of this spontaneous emission rate is just to say how much power is radiating the dipole, if it is in free space, or if it is close to the surface. What happens is that, for instance, if you are radiating in free space, you are going to be bounded by the sphere, and ideally the dipole is going to emit all momentum all wave with a wide variety of momentum, but they are going to be coupled to free space only that are attached to the sphere. However, if you have the surface with a hyperbolic topology, you are going to have a much larger amount of states where the energy of the dipole can go. And that means, and we just make this analysis where we are just varying the two conductivity components of the anisotropic metasurfaces, and we can see this is just the spontaneous emission rate in logarithm scale. Like if we are in the elliptic topology, like for instance, this is graphene will be around here, we can have an enhancement of one or two order of magnitude or three compared to what you would have in free space. But if you have hyperbolic, or if you are exactly in the point of the topological transition, we can have enhancement which can be like six, seven order of magnitude. Of course, it's very important here to consider that this is going to be large when the dipole is really, really close to the surface. Because if it is very far away, the free space is going to filter out all of the momentum, and there is not going to be energy that is going to remain to be coupled to the surface. So one possibility that we can use all of these hyperbolic metasurfaces or anisotropic metasurfaces is just to canalize or do a tunneling of the energy and to send it to a single direction. There has been like a lot of work in the past about this, where you can have a subwavelength resolution and you can just direct all the wave numbers towards a single direction, and that was one of the main ideas. So inspired by these works in the bulk, what we were trying to obtain is like, how can we, if we have a source and we locate a source close to this hyperbolic metasurface, we can see that all the momentum that are radiated and are going to be coupled to the surface, they are going to be directed into a single direction, into a unique direction. So there are like some conditions that we can work out to have here. And most likely the idea of the concept is something like that. You have just a dipole. We can just send surface, it's going to excite surface plasma. But when you go to the interface, we want that all of them goes exactly into the single direction. And in order to do so, the condition that we need to find is that one of the components of the conductivity tensor must be much larger than the other one. But it was very interesting, but this has to be in the absolute value. So it means that even if we have a lot of loss along one direction, but we have like an anisotropic loss, this is also going to enhance and contribute the propagation along a single direction. So this is like one nice application of this hyperbolic metasurface. And here we just a simulation where we just put one dipole at the interface between graphene and one of these engineered metasurfaces operating in canalization. And we can see how, in the case of graphene, all the energy is like we have the isotropic propagation. And in the other case, it's going towards a unique direction. Another topic which are also working right now is how can hyperbolic metasurfaces affect the optical forces that are related to a particle that are located nearby. If we just have a particle in front of silver and you illuminate the particle with light, so you are going to excite this particle, and if we assume it's really, really, really small, it's going to acquire some polarization, it's going to excite some plasma that are going to be unidirectional, and it's going to experience a recoil force that is going to be in the direction opposite to the momentum. And just for momentum conservation, the force that the particle is going to experience is going to be proportional, and it's not linear, to this wave number. So what we were recently thinking is like, okay, this has like a very large number of applications. And usually you need a very large intensity in order to manipulate these particles. And in biology and to manipulate cells, it's really, really necessary to control these small particles located near surfaces. So what happens is that if we substitute, for instance, these previous surfaces, isotropic surfaces, and we have a hyperbolic metasurface or an isotropic, and we illuminate it with a TM wave. So this TM wave, the energy is going to be reflected in the surface, the particle is going to be polarized, is going to excite as an isotropic plasmon on the anisotropic metasurfaces. That is going to, you have the wave vector in this direction, this is the pointing vector, and it's going to experience a recoil force that is going to be very large. So if we make just some simulation, in this case, it's like if we have an isotropic metasurface, this is like the particle is in the center, we can see how we excite the plasmon unidirectionally in one direction. And it's strong, we can see the effect, but when we replace that by a hyperbolic metasurface, we notice that the plasmon excited there, because the particle is located in the near field, there is the amount, the wave number excited was much larger, and the total amount of forces that the particle was experienced was very, very large. And in this case, we just theoretically were trying to do the experiment in the coming months. We demonstrated a few order of magnitude enhancement compared to an isotropic metasurface. Again, if we have the particle that is located far away, that is not in the near field of the hyperbolic metasurface, we are not going to observe this phenomenon. So this is like an alternative applications that we can have with this type of materials. And in this slide, I'm going to just briefly discuss an experiment very similar to the one that Professor Menon just figured it out. So we just located MOS2 a monolayer just on top of a metasurface. And this metasurface is just made of silver with some groove. So our idea is that when we illuminate this with linearly polarized light, so we want to couple to one of the valleys that is going to be related to circular polarized right-handed or left-handed, and spatially separate the energy towards different directions. So in this case, how are we going to do that? Well, the approach that he presented is like he has like a resonant metasurface that he was able to provide an in-plane circular momentum. What we are doing is very, very similar. So what we are doing is to making an asymmetry in the groups, therefore that we are, when we have in-plane circular polarized dipole, it's going to couple along one direction, and when we have on the other polarization, it's going to couple on the other direction. So we just made the experiment. We have the paper under review, so it's like really very, very, very similar. I wasn't aware of your work. I'm sorry for that. I should have mentioned here.
We haven't published it. We haven't even written it up. So.
Okay. So here we just have some pictures. This is like the control metasurface, and this is like the one. We couldn't make in our simulation, we obtained the best result when we just make this slope, like continuous slope, but we weren't able to do that in the lab, so we just make like a transition with like two steps, and then we were able to obtain it in that way. And this is like the helicity, so we can see when we have the asymmetric growth that we can have a very clear separation between the right-handed and left-handed emission. This is photoluminescence measurements. This is with asymmetric growth, and this is with flat silver. We have some small, but this is kind of a random distribution. So we were kind of happy with these measurements. And in the last 5 minutes, I just want to talk very briefly about how can we try to use graphene to break reciprocity in the absence of magnetic fields. So if we want to, well, I think everybody knows reciprocity, which is just come from time reversal symmetry, and the fact, like the very easy way to say that is that if I'm able to see you, you are going to be able to see me, more or less. And it has like many applications, for instance, to develop isolators, to develop circulators, and it is really necessary to break reciprocity. How can we break reciprocity assuming that we have a linear medium? Well, we can use a magnet, but this is something that we want to avoid because it's very difficult to, it's not compatible with an integrated circuit, and it's something that we want to avoid. We can just have transistor with a direct current, and in those cases, the amount of power that they are able to handle is kind of limited. We can also have angular momentum, and this is something, the way that I would like to explain this is like if you let me go to acoustic very quickly, and we have a circulator here where you can just send an acoustic wave here, and usually the energy, the acoustic wave is going to split equally to both ports. However, this was an experiment made by Professor Aluico works on UT Austin, and they just put like three CPU fans inside the circulator, so they made the airflow. It's very simple. When I was there and I saw the experiment, I was like, oh my, that was the cover of science. And it was like three CPU fans just moving the air. So the experiment was very simple, and it was able to break reciprocity just because the air, the acoustic wave, was just following the trend of the movement of the air. It's very simple, but yeah, I really like that experiment. Then they extended the concept to microwave, just using paractors, etc. And of course, I mean, one of the fundamental papers using linear momentum and angular momentum was by Sanhui Fan from Stanford, that they proposed that using silicon and doping silicon, etc. But what I was thinking is, like, can we try to apply this, for instance, at terahertz or infrared? We can try to explain adapt this concept. What happened if we use graphene? Well, one of the papers of graphene to have Faraday rotation was developed by Professor Kuzmenko in Geneva, where they applied 7 tesla to a sample of graphene in order to demonstrate Faraday rotation. I was there, and in order to have 7 tesla, you have a huge magnet, and the sample was tiny. So I really liked the experiment. The physics was amazing, but I was somehow saying, okay, if we want to integrate this, we need to get rid of this room of magnets in order to obtain somehow non-reciprocity with graphene. So this is somehow the motivation of this part of the talk. And what I just wanted to do very briefly to point is that if we apply usually a DC bias, we're able to control graphene properties. But recent papers is like, if we bias graphene with some speed, we're able to it's able to modulate that up to 100 gigahertz, and it has been demonstrated experimentally up to 30, 40 gigahertz, which is pretty high. So what we were just investigating is, like, if we can apply this concept of modulating spatiotemporally the properties of graphene in order to break reciprocity. And how are we gonna do that? Well, this is like, let me just consider a graphene sheet here, assume that the presence of the dielectric is not going to be very important. We just have the dispersion relation. We have the forward and the backward mode. And if we just modulate graphene, we just have a spatial modulation. We are going to just have an infinite number of Floquet harmonics. We are going to have a band gap here. And this is going to be the conductivity profile. If we just make this move, because we are modulating graphene with some time variation, what we're going to create is we're going to break the symmetry of the dispersion diagram, and we're going to create this type of responses. So if we operate here, we're going to have this state where the energy is going to be able to go forward. But if we're going on the other direction, we're going to be somehow forbidden because we don't have any state to work. These are just some Fourier simulations where we can we just prove the idea of the operation frequency F naught. And here the energy, it is very interesting. When you go to on the other port, the energy reflected back and converted to a different frequency, which is the modulation frequency that is given by the system. We have some frequency conversion. We can extend it to several other systems and even liquid wave antennas, but I just want to skip this part. And I just want to say that one of the major problems of this is that graphene, in order to have this, we need the coherent lens, and we're going to have a lot of loss. That means that even though our isolation could be very large, we can have isolation of 20 dBs, our loss is going to be so large that this is going to be impractical. So very recently, there was this work by Professor Lipson in, I think now it's in Columbia? Yes, before it was in Cornell. Yeah, so in this work, she proposed this waveguide, which was just a photonic standard dielectric supporting a mode, where they just used graphene as a perturbation of the waveguide here. So they were able to demonstrate a very large modulation of the properties of graphene. They were able to achieve over 30 gigahertz and a very huge contrast. So what we are proposing right now and trying to do the experiment is, like, what happens if we do that with graphene? So we are not want to use graphene as a, as the major platform to propagate the energy, but just as a perturbation in order to make the coupling between different agent states. So in that case, we just have the waveguide, we just have the modes that are propagated on the waveguide, and we are just going to use graphene just to very barely perturb the modes that are low loss and are propagating here. So if we, if disappear, So we just made some analysis. This is like some full wave results, where we can see that at some particular operation frequency, we can have a very large isolation over 20 or 30 dBs, but we are still keeping the loss very, very low. We are talking about between 2 and 5 dBs of loss, which is really low compared to alternative approaches. The good point of this, just let me skip the framework, is that we can expand this to many other systems. For instance, this was just a single waveguide. We can just make a ring in order to reduce the footprint, and still we're going to have very large isolation with moderate moderate loss. Here we can see some animation of this concept. Or we can even, is this thing moving? Yes. So we can also consider like a waveguide that is able to support two modes, and then just assume the transition, an interband transition between different modes. In order, for instance, we just fit the waveguide at F0 with this even mode, and this is all the energy here is going to be isolated, and all the energy has been transferred to a different frequency and a different mode that can be easily filtered out. So yeah, there is like, if we play with this and we engineer a little bit this photonic transition using graphene, we can also have some relatively high bandwidth of the non-reciprocity, because we have more degrees of freedom than when we only have one mode. And yeah, I'm just going to skip this because time is going. So I just want to thank you very much for the invitation. Most likely, I just want to give you an overview how we can use graphene or 2D materials, not as a matter of study by the material itself, but how can we apply this to a different system and how it can be used for other part of the technology. And I would like to thank you, my PhD students at the University of California, Davis, my collaborators, and thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'll be very happy to answer.
I'll ask a question. Now, this last thing we were talking about, mm-hmm. Putting the things on the waveguides, right?
Yes.
And this is like a terahertz-sized waveguide, right?
Yes.
So I mean, it's pretty big, right?
Yes, but we don't need to modulate the entire thing.
Right, right. But you still have to kind of get the. What I was kind of wondering is that you still have probably millimeter-sized. Parts. Or what would be like the dimensions of the?
In this case, we were in this example, we were modulating exactly the same section as in the paper of Lipson. So we were just give me 1 second.
Okay, so actually, the modulation section can be quite small then.
It's gonna be you're gonna need to print a lot of pads. We were talking about between 50 and 100 pads. But the modulation frequency that you need that we are doing in this work is below that what has been experimentally demonstrated in the paper of Lipson. So right now, what is going to be the challenge, and we are suffering that right now, is just to make the gating paths in order to obtain this this coupling between the modes using graphene. So that's like the challenge that we are facing right now.
Okay. No, I was just kind of wondering about like things like the RC time cost is just associated with these.
The RC. Yeah, that's totally right. I mean, in fact, for instance, in the paper that I presented at the beginning with the two layer of in that case, the modulation frequency that I got, it was like 5 gigahertz, which was not close enough to develop this type of work. However, with the modulation frequency demonstrated by Lipson. It was around 30, 35 experimentally, and all the simulation has been with 20 gigahertz. So we have a lot of margin. We are trying to, since this is kind of theoretical, we always want to have some extra room, because we know that when we go to the lab, we are going to lose a lot, and then we can always try to compensate. So then the experiments make more sense.
Okay, also in the middle section, you have this like hyperbolic in-plane structures and so forth. Is the gate tunability of 2D material like an important aspect?
Or not too much? Yeah, it could be. Something that you can do with that is like, let me go first. The fact that you have the hyperbolic response is not due to the gate, but the fact that you apply a gate, you can control, not in real time, but almost, what is going to be the isofrequency control. So you can control the properties of the hyperbolic medium that and how are the properties of the width after are being traveling there. So yeah.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.